www.livenepal.tv, connecting the world.
Well, to begin with, I must express my gratitude to India Foundation, which very kindly brought me here to participate in this great event. More than that, they have given me an absolutely formidable responsibility, which I don't think I deserve. Such an eminent panel of one former Prime Minister of Nepal, one very senior leader who has worked in various capacities, and even now is struggling to define the parameters of Nepali politics, and two seasoned members of parliament from India. It's really a formidable panel, and I certainly do not deserve to be where I am. But you know, the chairman are and moderators, if you call it, are expected to listen more and speak less. And that's what I will try to do. I shall therefore not come up with any initial presentations, but probably say something at the end of the discussion. We have an hour and a half at our disposal, and we have four speakers. It would be ideal if the speakers confined to 12 to 15 minutes maximum, so that we at least have half an hour for the gathering to interact. The issue which we have before us is indeed very sensitive and very important. It's not only Nepal which is struggling to have an inclusive democracy. In fact, democracy and inclusion are umbilically linked. There is no democracy if it is not inclusive. And therefore, we have to keep that perspective in mind. With these few words, I will request the panelists to speak for, since all the panelists have been already introduced and they really don't need any introduction in this gathering, I would request them to speak for 12 to 15 minutes. I can be very uncivilized if time boundaries are crossed. And teachers don't know either the diplomatic niceties or political nuances. So we can be very blunt, and I would request, therefore, kindly to keep to the time limit in the interest of a better discussion, because then you will get again a chance to respond to some of these queries and observations. With these remarks, may I first request Dr. Baburam Bhattarai, former Prime Minister of Nepal.
Respected Chairman. Respected Chairperson, distinguished and honourable members of the panel, excellencies, friends. We are gathered here to engage in a very promising and seminal discussion on pertinent themes related to Nepal and India. It is an honour for me to be amidst such an eminent group of panelists, as well as in the audience, who have contributed widely towards strengthening Nepal-India relations. So at the outset, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the organizers of this India-Nepal dialogue for providing me this opportunity to share my thoughts on a theme that is immensely relevant to the politics and people of both Nepal and India. The topic, Inclusive Democracy, Experiences India-Nepal, provides an opening for us to reflect upon the democratic trajectory of both these nations. India has had a rich history of engaging with democratic principles and institutions, making itself known today as the largest and one of the most vibrant democracies in the world. The people of Nepal, who have fought relentlessly for several decades against autocratic regimes, today our quest for institutionalization of democratic republic has been realized rather late. Nevertheless, a maturing democracy and an infant republic have much to share with each other regarding the lessons to be learned and the answers that need to be sought. Today, democracy has acquired universal sanction and attribution as the desirable system of rule or governance. Yet, there is no certainty or agreement about the specific components or process of democracy. Therefore, it is not surprising that some of the core controversies of politics and political theory continue to revolve around the question of what does it mean to make our democracy more democratic. Particularly, the crisis that representative democracies the world over are facing is indeed very disconcerting. On the other hand, you have increasing socio-economic inequalities and political crises brewing within liberal democracies. On the other hand, there are social systems that can constrict basic political rights and freedoms in the name of addressing the socio-economic domains. Therefore, I think it has some imperative to indulge in a thought-provoking discussions about striving for a democracy that is superior to these conventional models of democracy. I would primarily like to focus on discussing the challenges that confront Nepal's quest for realizing a truly democratic polity and society. Together with a diagnosis of the ills, I would also like to raise some points that may be useful in understanding what inclusive democracy would actually mean in Nepal's context and why the concept of inclusion is the most crucial indicator of Nepal's success in its democratic endeavor. Nepal is unique in the sense that although it is a small country geographically, there is an enormous diversity of races, languages, religions and cultures. Yet, it has taken a long time for the Nepali state and its political rulers to acknowledge the inequality in political and socio-economic rights among various groups within this valued diversity. Historically speaking, previous autocratic regimes and its political legal institutions have been the legitimizing protectors of those exploiting and excluding a large section of the people from participation and representation in state structures. However, the past few decades in Nepalese politics have been characterized by a massive upsurge in demands for ensuring inclusion of such groups, which have been marginalized on the basis of ethnicity, nationality, region, gender, caste, religion and language. It is in such a context that the Maoists, in concert with the new political forces, Madhesis and Adivasi Janatis, had major contestations with the traditional political parties over the cast of new constitution. In Nepal, the abolition of monarchy and a prolonged obscurity regarding the new political system that would replace it created a major political void. Post 2006, the political trajectory of democracy in Nepal can be viewed in light of the struggle between political parties over by filling this void with new political institutions and constitutional provisions. Some of the key points of contestations directly surrounded the question of democracy and its configuration, particularly regarding its ability to pave the way for a stable and peaceful Nepal in the upcoming days, can be evaluated in the light of its capacity to fulfill the latter objective, that of inclusive democracy. Although the new constitution comes with some promising provisions, it is rather unfortunate to note that the outcomes of the second constituent assembly did not faithfully reflect the achievements of the first constituent assembly. Among the most notable achievements that it failed to uphold in the final constitution was the identification of the basis for federal restructuring on 5 criteria of identity and 4 criteria of capability fixed by the first constituent assembly. Additionally, the formation of autonomous states for nationalities with more than 1% of the total population, which would amount to 9 to 10 states as agreed upon by the State Restructuring Committee of the First Constituent Assembly and the State Restructuring Committee was also discarded. Many progressive provisions aimed at equal and just treatment of women, Dalits and Muslims which were analyzed in the first CA were cast off in the second CA. As a consequence, today we can see right before our own eyes that in spite of getting a new constitution which codifies the concept of inclusive democracy, there are serious dissatisfactions among those who feel left out, particularly the Madhesi, Arus and Adivasi Janatis. It is in this context that I consider it important to underline that inclusive democracy on its own would not yield a fair and equal representation. This is because the groups included in state institutions would still be numerically underrepresented. Therefore, it is significant to hyphenate the principle of inclusion with the provision for proportional allocation of political space. Therefore, even a system of proportional representation would be insufficient to address the task of doing away with the unitary centralized structure of the state. Unless the histories and culture of ethno-lingual regional communities are justly recognized, devolution of power alone would not fulfill the aspirations of a large section of the people. Hence, in the Nepalese context, the agenda of federalism is intrinsically associated with the call for inclusive and proportional representative democracy. The current demands for constitutional amendments need to be viewed in this light. The proposition of proportional, inclusive and participative democracy in the consideration of the three clusters proposed by Nyaya Shakti Party may be considered useful in this context. If we look into the composition of Nepalese society, the population distribution of three broad clustered communities can be broadly identified as those of Khas Aryas being one-third, Madhesi Tharus as being one-third, and the Adivasi Janatis as being the other one-third of our total population. Although the new constitution has resolved many issues, the basic contradictions between the distribution of rights among these three clusters have remained unsolved. The continuation of agitations and dissatisfaction in the regions where Madhesi Tharus and Adivasi Janatis are in majority is a response to this discrepancy. It makes no sense to speak of national integrity and social cohesion by superficially assimilating two-thirds of the population under the homogenizing and monopolizing impulses of one particular cluster. Although the principle of inclusive representative democracy has now been formally recognized, unless an agreement on the arrangement and structure of federal units is reached and the criteria of inclusion is made clear, uncomplicated and proportional implementation of our constitutional provisions will become a tough task. It is but obvious that if we are to look forward towards a better, peaceful and stable Nepal, we cannot afford to remain stuck in this political quagmire. Therefore, in consideration of the concrete specificities of Nepal, Nepal's rainbow nation character, we need to accept not just individual rights, but collective group rights as well. We need to provide for not just formal equality, but also make provisions for special rights and affirmative actions. More specifically and immediately, we need to push for constitutional amendments to meet the demands of the Madhesis, Tharus and Janatis based on the recommendation of the State Restructuring Commission. During my tenure as the Prime Minister and later as the Chairperson of the Constitutional Political Dialogue and Consensus Committee, I made relentless efforts until the very end to push for timely rectification and realization of the issue. It is painful to see that my forewarnings then have proved over time to be true. I believe that India being among the first few democracies to take innovative and bold initiative to recognize the rights of minorities and cultural diversity, its experiences can provide valuable inputs to its neighboring country. The fact that cultural diversity was affirmed and protected in India, that minority communities received special representation in the Constituent Assembly during the framing of independent India's constitution are reason enough to assert that India is most aptly placed to understand our ongoing struggle to make democracy in Nepal more meaningful and all-encompassing. I would like to end by making a final assessment that in order to make our democratic polity stable and strong, we also need to prioritize our developmental pursuits and bring prosperity to the Nepali people. Economic disparities among our people would only aggravate the existing political tensions. Therefore, inclusive democracy would be incomplete without ensuring inclusive development. Given Nepal's peculiar geostrategic location, we believe that Nepal can and must play a dynamic role in facilitating and enhancing greater economic activities between India and China. It is but obvious that a perpetually poor, insecure, and unstable Nepal would not only be detrimental to our own people and our national sovereignty, but also unfavorable to our immediate neighbors. Therefore, I would like to make a call for consolidating inclusive democracy with inclusive development through shared prosperity with India, which would be the best guarantee for our mutual security. Thank you.